Hello, good morning, everybody. So today we have Ms. Sriparna Saha with us, who is going to talk us through about doing PhD from foreign universities and especially the USA. A little bit brief about Sriparna. Sriparna has done her BSc honors in geology and then her MS in earth science from Jadavpur University. Then she moved on to Texas, USA to do her PhD from Rice University. And presently, Sriparna is in New Zealand and she is doing her further research on the use of digital storytelling for improving understanding of volcanic processes. Welcome to Education View 360, Sriparna.
Thank you. Hi everyone. It's really nice to be here. And yeah, Praveen, thank you for reaching out. I guess I really want to acknowledge that this effort, you are creating this opportunity and this platform for students. I think it's really needed because when I was in school, I didn't know about all this stuff. So it's really amazing that you're doing that. Just a shout out to you for that.
Thank you so much. Sriparna, so now we are moving on to your PhD work. So kindly explain to our students what is the entire detailed process that one needs to follow if somebody has to take a PhD from a foreign university and especially from the US.
There are PhD institutes, all institutes in India also offer PhD. And even in the US, it's some people choose to do their PhD from abroad, some choose to do it in India. The main target while choosing or the main deciding factor while choosing where to pursue a PhD from must come from what is it that the student is interested in understanding or finding out. That is very critical because PhD is a commitment. And if you don't enjoy what you're doing, you will burn out. So it's really important that you're so passionate and you just love what you're doing. Then it won't seem like hard work because it's challenging anyway, but it's what you think is worth fighting for. I would put it that way. For a PhD position in the US, you have to take two exams. One is the GRE, which is the graduate record examination, and an English proficiency examination. It can be either TOEFL, Test of English as Foreign Language, or IELTS. Sometimes, depending on which university you are applying for, they'll tell you what their English language requirements are. But for all PhD programs, GRE is mandate, and universities may have a preference for which English language exam they want. And I'll talk a little bit about the exam as well.
Yes.
So the GRE exam has two parts. One is a quant section and one is a qualitative section. The quantitative section has to do about math up to 10th standard or maybe some calculus, but it's so the exam itself is computer adaptive. So as you are solving the questions, if the system sees that, okay, you are doing well, it will start to give you tougher questions. But that's how they are gauging you. And so therefore, it's very important to keep your mind calm while you're taking the exam. But it's not that hard. I myself took 2 months of preparation before the exam. And then I appeared for the exam. And then the qualitative section is basic English understanding, but it's more analytical thinking because in your research, you are supposed to read, you'll be reading all these scientific articles and papers, right? So you have to understand what is the take-away message. So this test is just a way for the universities to gauge if you have that capacity to comprehend what information is being given to you. So the quant is kind of assessing that, you have some data. Are you able to understand that data? Are you able to interpret it? And qualitative is about if you're reading a paper, then what do you understand? That's broadly it. And then there is one argumentative section, which is an essay. So you have to I think there were two essays. And the ETS website has if students are interested, they can go to the ETS who organizes the exam. They can just go there and they have all the details of the exam there. Similarly for TOEFL as well, all the details are available. And then after you've taken your exam, the next part is a little bit varied depending on what field you are in. For example, in science fields, some universities. So you work with an advisor, like you work with a supervisor. And when I said that it's very important to identify what subject you are interested in pursuing, that's what you're looking for. It's like, who's doing what kind of research, you know? And the way to do that is go on the net, like find out, okay, what universities or what people. For example, if I'm interested in something around volcanology, you know, so I will search for people doing that specific kind of research. And then universities here in the US maintain their websites. So you can go to the websites, read more about their work, reach out to them by email. People are pretty good in answering that. They're very supportive. So if you have questions or if you just want to get an informational interview, you know, like just want to know that what is it that it's happening, what kind of research they do, they'll welcome you and like they're happy to chat with you. So if that's a path that you would like to take, you're totally like encourage you to do that, because it also gives you a sense of what kind of people you'll be going to work with. Right? Like if you like that person. And for example, in even in school, you know, like some teachers are like students' favorites. They really enjoy their classes. So even PhD is like that. But if you have a person who's very supportive, your advisor is super helpful and efficient and knowledgeable, so you learn a lot during the process. You reach out to them. They may tell you that, okay, they are looking to hire next semester or so. If that's the case, there's like a formal application process. So you have to send your GRE and the TOEFL scores to the university. And then each university has it differently. Some universities, or specifically even some departments, the way they do it is you send your scores to the university, and then like say you get through, it's after that you are assigned a supervisor with whom you work. But in some cases, you know from before, you approach the person, and then having information from that person, he or she says that okay, I'm interested in working with you, and encourages you to apply for the position, and you apply, and then it works out. So it depends on like the subject domain as well as university. So that's quite different.
Wow, that's very, very detailed information. I just have one question to ask. So at what stage of your post-graduation do you start doing that?
Ideally, it actually depends on like the student specifically. For example, some people might want to take a gap year before they want to go abroad, because it's like when you go to a different country, takes a bit of a time to settle in, and it's not immediately that you can go back. So just taking that, like for example, I took 1 year time to prepare and like take my exam and then apply, because I didn't want to rush it. But some people they start looking even from last year of their postgrads. And I think the earlier you start the conversation, it's better. You have more insight and more information about like, you know, idea of, okay, this is something that interests me, and it just gives you more time. But there's no hard and fast rule that you have to have like this amount of time. But of course, if you, I wouldn't also encourage like waiting for 2 to 3 years before applying, because then there's a gap in your, like, you know, if you're working, that's different. If getting into academia is what you want to do, then the earlier you start the process, it's better.
Thank you for your inputs, Sriparna. So moving on to our next question, what are the prospects and scope of a PhD degree from abroad vis-a-vis when you do it from India?
Depends on a lot of factors. For example, like I don't think students will be aware of the like career path of a PhD. So what happens is after you like, so a PhD, even in India, at all universities, PhD is a must if you want to teach at a university, right? It's an essential degree. So of course that's there. But the path from a PhD to getting that position is like, there are a number of steps involved. There's also like a postdoctoral research, which is like an intermediate step. So that's, in a PhD, you're working with an advisor, and he's funding your research. research mostly, and you are like, you are still learning in that process. You are still a student, but after you get your PhD, you in a postdoc position, you are pursuing more independent research. You're still working with somebody. For example, somebody has this huge project and they want some people to help them with that, so they would hire like some postdocs to work on that. But it's mostly like you are an expert in your field, and now you are bringing your information or your knowledge to a project and leading it forward with the PI or the primary investigator of that project. Of course, that's the main, like, you, like, if you want to get like tenure track position. And by tenure track, I mean teacher or researchers who are like professors or assistant professors who are still doing active research, who are publishing, and who are also teaching. So it's like a two roles that they are playing. They are doing active research, but they're also teaching. So that's the kind of job prospect that's the most apparent. But then some people like me, I just enjoy research a lot. So I'm still continuing my research. If you enjoy research, I think PhD is really good. But then also, even in the industry, for people who are interested in industry, PhD is quite a valued degree, because it's not just about the subject domain. It's not just that you're becoming an expert in a specific field. You're also gaining a lot of transferable skills, for example, working in groups, doing multiple projects at the same time. And all these skills are very valued in the industry. So I have seen people who have worked in the industry for a while come to get a PhD, you know, and then either they are working in academia, they stay on in academia, or they go back to the industry. Like, it has made me a different person prior to, like, before I started my PhD and after I finished it, I totally transformed. So it's like a really different kind of experience.
Very, very insightful. And you've, I think, given a lot of clarity, because number of times students are confused. They get into industry from college placements, then they are still not sure whether they want to get into industry or they want to move on to academia. So that insight is very useful that you've given, that it's very liberal, and you have seen live examples where people have come out from industry, done their PhD, gone back either to industry or to academia.
Right.
That's great. Yeah. That's great information. So, Sriparna, moving on to our last question for the day. Please tell us about the financial aspects of doing PhD from USA, and how does one sustain oneself?
Okay, so the good thing about the PhD programs in the US are that most of them are funded. So if you get into a good university and you're working with a PI who has like good funding, then you are given an annual, like a stipend, you're given a monthly stipend, and all your tuition is covered. Oh, one thing that I forgot to mention is that PhD in the US involves 2 years of coursework. So the first 2 years, you do your research, but you are also taking like different courses. Some of them might be relevant, maybe directly or indirectly related to something that you are interested in pursuing, but there's no like a set curriculum for that. It depends on your interest, and usually students work with their like graduate like coordinators to find which course is relevant for them, and so they're supposed to complete their coursework within the first 2 years, and then it's like 3 years of just research. And so the university, like, generally I have been fortunate to work with people who had like complete funding. So when I was in the US, I didn't have to worry about the financial aspects, but there are also opportunities where the department offers teaching assistantships. So what it does is that you are paid, like, you're doing your research, you're studying, but you're also teaching, like you're supporting some courses with the primary instructors of that course. So you're paid for that. So it works either ways. And again, that's very university specific. For example, if you go for a position, PhD position in Europe or other countries, it's not that, funding wise, it's not that convenient. So it might be a stress, or, you know, know, like a financial burden. So just like when I said that there's no rush to like, you know, immediately take the leap of, okay, I want to do my PhD right after my postgrad. It's also about figuring out these things, okay, the funding, who has, what is the most feasible for you? Because it's a little bit tricky on that front. You want to be in a position where you are financially independent, and if you like, the stipend is enough to cover all your expenses. But if you don't have a stipend, and it can get tricky, because in the US you're not allowed, your student visa doesn't allow you to work, which makes it harder. But there are opportunities for internships and stuff, but it's not enough. So yeah, looking for funded PhD positions is really the key, talking to the right people, and just having a chat with more people and around the university. You can reach out to the graduate coordinators, like just finding out, you know, that what are the opportunities, and they are pretty good at like laying out, okay, these are the opportunities in our department, and then they can guide you towards what is it that you are interested in. Yeah, to the right people, they can connect you to the right people.
Yeah, that was going to be actually my next question. Who are the people to be approached to know more about?
Yeah,
you've already answered that. Thank you. So my one doubt which crept up is that I want to clarify. You said that 2 years of coursework is there. So you want funding starts from the very first day you start?
Yes. So it's like, so a typical duration of PhD in the US is 5 years and above, because again, it's department and domain specific. For example, in sciences, it generally takes 5+ years. And if you have a funded PhD, it generally covers like the 5 year duration, 5 years of your study. And yeah.
Thank you so much for being with us, Reeparna. It was very insightful to talk to you, and I'm sure the information you shared will help the students a long way. And to these students, we are trying to create a community here where the students pitch in to help each other with the authentic information. So stay tuned and keep subscribing.
If you have any questions, feel free to reach out, or if any student wants to, you know, like know more about geology, happy to help in any way I can.
Thank you so much.